بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله الحمد لله الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونؤمن به ونتوكل عليه ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا. من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلله فلا هادي له. ونشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له. ونشهد أن سيدنا ونبينا وشفيعنا وحبيبنا وسندنا وولانا محمدا عبده ورسوله صلى الله تبارك وتعالى عليه وعلى آله وأصحابه وبارك وسلم تسليما كثيرا كثيرا. أما بعد، فأعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله وكونوا مع الصادقين. وقال تعالى: بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. والعصر إن الإنسان لفي خسر إلا الذين آمنوا وعملوا الصالحات وتواصوا بالحق وتواصوا بالصبر. وقال تعالى: فلا اقتحم العقبة وما أدراك ما العقبة، فك رقبة أو إطعام في يوم ذي مسغبة، يتيما ذا مقربة أو مسكينا ذا مقربة. ثم كان من الذين آمنوا وتواصوا بالصبر وتواصوا بالمرحمة أولئك أصحاب الميمنة والذين كفروا بآياتنا هم أصحاب المشأمة عليهم نار مؤصدة. وقال تعالى: هل ينظرون إلا الساعة أن تأتيهم بغتة وهم لا يشعرون؟ الأخلاء يومئذ بعضهم لبعض عدو إلا المتقين. وقال تعالى: وأقبل بعضهم على بعض يتساءلون، قال قائل منهم: إني كان لي قرين يقول وإنك لمن المصدقين، أإذا منا وكنا ترابا وعظاما أإنا لمدينون، قال هل أنتم مطلعون؟ فاطلع فرآه في سواء الجحيم، قال تالله إن كدت لتردين، ولولا نعمة ربي لكنت من المحضرين، أفما نحن بميتين إلا موتتنا الأولى وما نحن بمعذبين. إن هذا لهو الفوز العظيم، لمثل هذا فليعمل العاملون. أذلك خير نزلا أم شجرة الزقوم؟ إنا جعلناها فتنة للظالمين. وقال تعالى: ويوم يعض الظالم على يديه يقول: يا ليتني اتخذت مع الرسول سبيلا، يا ويلتى ليتني لم أتخذ فلانا خليلا، لقد أضلني عن الذكر بعد إذ جاءني، وكان الشيطان للإنسان خذولا. وقال النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم: سبعة يظلهم الله في ظله يوم لا ظل إلا ظله: إمام عادل، وشاب مشى في عبادة الله عز وجل، ورجل قلبه معلق بالمساجد، ورجلان تحابا في الله اجتمعا عليه وتفرقا عليه، إلى آخر الحديث. وقال عليه الصلاة والسلام: يقول الله سبحانه وتعالى يوم القيامة: أين المتحابون بجلالي؟ اليوم ظلهم في ظلي يوم لا ظل إلا ظلي. وقال الله سبحانه وتعالى: وجبت محبتي للمتحابين في والمتجالسين في والمتبادلين في والمتسابلين في. أو كما قال النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم صدق الله مولانا العظيم وصدق رسوله النبي الكريم ونحن على ما قال ربنا وخالقنا ورازقنا من الشاهدين والشاكرين والحمد لله رب العالمين إن الله وملائكته يصلون على النبي يا أيها الذين آمنوا صلوا عليه وسلموا تسليما اللهم صل على سيدنا محمد وعلى آل سيدنا محمد كما صليت على سيدنا إبراهيم وعلى آل سيدنا إبراهيم إنك حميد مجيد اللهم بارك على سيدنا محمد وعلى آل سيدنا محمد كما باركت على سيدنا إبراهيم وعلى آل سيدنا إبراهيم إنك حميد مجيد Respected elders, brothers, friends, first of all we thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for giving us tawfiq to sit in the house of Allah to learn something about our beautiful deen of Islam. May Allah give me the tawfiq to say something beneficial for all of us. And may Allah give us the tawfiq to put into practice whatever we learn. Today's topic is about social media. Halal, haram, jayiz, na jayiz. I would say halal, haram, ki bajaye benefits and harms. Haram ko harm ko. Benefits and harms of social media. Pros and cons of social media. Social media kya hai pehle? You need to understand. What is social media? We ask Mufti Google sahab. What is social media? And Mufti Google sahab tells us, it is a term to describe websites and online tools which allow people to interact with each other by sharing information, opinions, knowledge, interests. It involves the building of communities, networks, encouraging participation and engagement. This is social media. On the internet, before we used to have only TVs, and then came Sky and cable, and then came computers, and then internet, www, World Wide Web, spider ki jali ki tarah se web, shikar karne ke liye, to capture and hunt the whole world in that web. And then came chat lines, and then came Facebook, and then came Twitter, and then came Weibo, and I don't know what, Allah, 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 Messenger, you know better than me, more than me. What is all these social websites? You know, before, when a person is sick and tired at home, doesn't know what to do, doesn't have much to do, he would go in a coffee shop, sit down, have a cup of coffee, relax. Someone else would come, sit with another cup of coffee, they both sitting in front of each other and bragging or blurting out everything that is in their heart and mind, having a shoulder to cry on and feeling at the end, after an hour, 2-3 hours conversation, they is a bit relieved, it feels a bit better now. And then he goes back home and that tension is away from his head. So this was a small cafe in which a person tells all his secrets to someone who's a stranger who he doesn't know. He just came for a cup of coffee and they start talking and he tells him everything and that person tells him his own secrets. And then they both go, finish, full stop. Now, after these internet chat rooms and Facebooks and Twitter, what's happening is that there is a huge cafe out there. And everybody, you are sitting in your home, the other person is sitting in Australia, New Zealand, Canada, Fiji, USA, Europe, America, Africa, Asia, Bangladesh, Pakistan, India, you don't know where, Nigeria, Algeria, whatever. You don't know where he's sitting. And you are telling him everything and he's telling you everything. So this is now a worldwide coffee shop. In that coffee shop, everybody is sitting there. And in that coffee shop, after an hour or 2 hours, the owner would kick you out. Oh, bhai, get out now. I want some new customers. But over here, there's nobody to kick you out. It's in your own home, you're in your own bedroom. And even if your mom calls you out, beta, come on, come down for tea. Then, oh, I'm busy. And with a Kanaka light, you have to pray the Mahnu and busy. And then you're on it for hours and hours. You don't go to sleep. You're on it till 11 o'clock, 12 o'clock, 1 o'clock, 2 o'clock, 3 o'clock. You don't know what time it is. And then you're trying to sleep, you can't sleep. Your sleep is gone. And then you keep thinking about those things. Now, from then on, after revealing all your secrets, what you're doing is now putting on your photos, okay, and then describing everything, telling everything what you had to eat today, what happened in your house, how your mom and dad had an argument, and you were into the fight, and then you did this and they did that, and everything you blurted out on that site. And you don't know who the other people are, who are watching you, who are looking at you, who are observing you. Now this has happened through this worldwide web. One person on Twitter has plenty of followers, and they all follow him. And then if something happens on that Twitter account, and then everybody gets inside, and then he gets heated up. And then you don't know what you're writing, what he's saying. Just a few days back, Amir Khan the boxer, he got involved on Twitter into an argument with some actress who was acting in the British Muslim documentary which was made. And the argument got heated up, and then they both started abusing one another, insulting, swearing, and all the others got into the argument as well. And the other people, the non-Muslims, are having a good time, making fun, and they are getting a buzz out of it. Look, this is the characters of Muslims. This is how Muslims are behaving. So on there, you don't know who's watching you, who's looking at your moves, who's reading your words, and you're just getting everything out on there, and your language is out of control, what you say is out of control, your photos are out of control, your life is out of control. This is social media. Now, we need to understand pros and cons, benefits and harm. There may be some benefits. For this bayan, I was getting ready, and I also have a Twitter account, so I posted on there that I have to go bayan tomorrow. Can I have some ideas? I need some help. Can you give me some, you know, ideas? What are the benefits and harms of social media? And I got some very nice suggestions from some friends, followers. I don't have much followers, but alhamdulillah, those who are following me, they alhamdulillah sent me some nice, observations, their own personal experiences. There may be some benefits in them. The first response I got was from someone. He said that I want to benefit from you, like yourself, and at the same time I want to ask you the same question: why are you on Twitter? I said, Jazakallah, thank you very much for your comment. But he said a nice thing. This is a benefit. On Twitter, I don't have a Facebook account, and I don't intend to open one as well. But on Twitter, you only have 140 characters, and you have to say everything in there. You have to be very intelligent to, you know, say some long message in short words, to phrase it out. You have to be very intelligent. And you have to choose the right letters, the right words, and you can't exceed the limit. So, Twitter is okay. I use it, alhamdulillah. I put some nice anecdotes, some advice, nasihat on there. So what he mentioned was the benefit of staying in the company of shuyukh. What he tried to say was that these days it's hard to get hold of ulama, mushayikh, sitting there, sohbah, and benefit from them. So someone is somewhere else in some remote area where there is no alim, maybe no masjid, nowhere to turn to, nowhere. There are places where, you know, people are growing up, young Muslims, they are maybe a doctor, an engineer, a businessman. He's living in a remote area where he can't see ulama. So he goes on maybe these types of, you know, good sites, visits shuyukh, benefits from them and learns from them. Okay? There is benefit, one benefit of the social media is staying in company of shuyukh, which this brother mentioned. Someone else said, gaining Islamic knowledge. I have learned a lot from the social media, which I could not have learned elsewhere. many objections, ask questions, and you get a response, and you get, you know, good answer, and you feel good, alhamdulillah. I had this question bugging in my mind, but now all the objections are removed, and I feel good. Someone else then, on social media, you can stay in touch with family and friends, which we can class as sila rahmi. That with my friends, I can, my family members, my brothers, my cousins, my nephews, my nieces, my family members, I can stay in touch with them, maybe sometime in another country, and we talk, and on social media is easier. Rather than having long 1 hour phone conversation, we build, it's cheaper, just send a message, they send you a message, sometimes it's free as well, so I use it. Another person said that rather than Twitter and Facebook, I prefer WhatsApp. Because on WhatsApp I have my own group of 30. Someone said that on WhatsApp I have my own group of Maktab students. And I teach them their sabak and their lessons and homework on WhatsApp group. I tell them you have to learn from here to there. And I tell them this is how you must learn it. And if by that way they can benefit from the WhatsApp group. So maybe there is some benefit in there which these people are mentioning. Also, some say there is good Islamic preaching on there as well. You will get some good websites, some good preaching, like on Twitter, you might have Hazrat Shaykh Rahmatullah's account, Hazrat Shaykh's biography, slowly, bit by bit is put on there, so you can read Hazrat Shaykh Zakariya Rahmatullah alayhi, his biography, maybe some of the Shuyukh Mashayikh. Someone else also said that promote Islamic events. Something is going to happen, you put it on Twitter, people find out and try to attend. Motivation of others, learning knowledge, which we've just mentioned, facts, news. Someone also said, business. You can promote your business on social media, that you've got this product going on. These are some of the benefits of social media. Now, two things should be kept in mind for deriving these benefits. Number one, intention. And number two, moderation. إِنَّمَا الْعَمَالُ بِالنِّيَّةِ. The intention of using that social media should be correct. If your intention is wrong, then you are doing something wrong. If your intention is not to derive any of these benefits, that means you are doing something wrong. If your intention is evil, then that act will also become evil. So your going on social media, in the eyes of Allah, will also become an evil thing if your intention is not right, if intention is not correct. So our intention should be correct. My intention of opening the Twitter account of myself should be correct. And those who visit my account, their intention should be correct as well. If our intentions are not correct, we will be held to account on the day of Qiyamah. Why did you do this for name and fame? Why did you do this for personal gain? Why did you do this for dunya, worldly benefit? And why did you not use it for deeni benefit? We will have to answer to Allah on the day of Qiyamah. First thing is, our intention should be correct. And number two, second thing is moderation. Moderation means don't waste too much time. Time limit, time management. Only go on it when you are free. You have time to go on there. And don't go beyond limits. Fix yourself a time, 10 minutes, 20 minutes, half an hour, maybe during some time of the day, in the evening maybe, when you come back from work, you are relaxing, rather than watching TV, you go on there, you read something a little bit, for maybe 10, 20 minutes, half an hour, okay. After that, you close it, and you do what you have to do. Your social engagements should not stop you from your duties. Be those duties, religious duties, or social duties within your home. Religious duties like salat, religious duties like learning your sabak, religious duties like going to the masjid to pray salah, and doing your homework which your ustad has given you, becoming hafiz, learning your sabak. Your duties, religious duties like getting up in the morning, reading Yasin Sharif, reading a little bit of Quran, it should not stop you from that. You should not have a habit of getting up in the morning, immediately on the phone, checking what's going on, how much I've got, what's going on the groups, on here, on there. That should not be your habit. You should close your phone when you go to sleep, get up in the morning, do your duties first, whatever you have to do. And then, when you get free, then you go watch on the, look on the, whatever replies you have to give, or whatever answers you have to give, you give answers on them. And you have to make, you know, habit of going to sleep early. Don't stay awake till too late. Maybe 10 o'clock for boys, it should be earlier. 8 o'clock, 9 o'clock, that should be the habit. We live in this country. Alhamdulillah, the intelligent people in this country, we can learn from them how things should be managed. You go to Oxford, you go to Cambridge University, the students who are going to become bright and progress, their time managed. And they manage their time. They don't waste time. Many of these doctors, registrars, lawyers, they don't have TV in their homes. They don't allow their children to watch TV. They have regulation. 8 o'clock, you have to do your homework. 8:30, 9 o'clock, you should be in your bed. And you should sleep for at least 7-8 hours. And their children sleep for that amount of time. And then they progress and they move on and they become, beneficent for the society. So, we have to manage our time and use these tools in moderation. Don't go beyond limit. This is the second thing which we need to understand. Intention and moderation. If you want to derive some benefits from the social media. Now, we move on to the harms and the cons and the nuksanat of social media. First of all, what we notice on the social media is there is too much nafsaniyat, ego worshipping, egoism, khaisha, desire. Most people go on this media for their own personal gain, nafsaniyat. Like Mufti Sahib was mentioning regarding maybe shahwat, watching pictures on Facebook, going into other people's accounts, watching what they are doing, and then looking at girls, looking at nudity and sin of the eye. This is what's happening on the media, and this is the reason why it's being used most of the time. Very few people have the right intentions to go on there. It's hard to control your love, it's not easy. And this is why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has stressed in so many places in the Quran with regards to nafs. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in Surah Al-Shamsi wa Duhaha took 7 qasams. How many? 7 qasams. And then Allah mentioned the ego and purifying and cleansing of the ego. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم والشمس وضحاها والقمر إذا تلاها والنهار إذا جلاها والليل إذا يغشاها والسماء وما بناها والأرض وما طحاها ونفس وما سواها فألهمها فجورها وتقواها. After 7 قصص of the sun, the moon, the night, the day, and Asman, Zameen, the heavens and the earth, and then the ego, the sun, the moon, the day, the night, the heavens and the earth, and then the nafs, ego, and Allah who created that ego, and Allah who inspired within that ego the fujur and the taqwa, the disobedience and the fear of Allah. Allah inspired both of them. Allah Masha'alani says, فَأَلْهَمْهَا فُجُورَهَا لِيَجْتَنِبَ عَنْهَا وَتَقْوَاهَا لِيَعْمَلَ بِهِ. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala inspired in fujur so he can stay away from it, and taqwa so that he can hold on to it. So Allah gave you both ways. إِنَّا عَلَيْنَاهُ السَّبِيلِ إِمَّا شَاكِرًا وَإِمَّا كَفُورًا. You have both plates in front of you. You have the plate of poison and you have the plate of fresh kebab. It's your choice. Take that poison or you take that fresh kebab, it's yours. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala did not force anyone to obey Allah or to believe in Allah or to practice. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave you free choice, free will, and you have to make the right choice. So Allah took 7 qasams, and then Allah said, قَدْ أَفْلَحَ مَنْ زَكَّاهَا وَقَدْ خَابَ مَنْ دَسَّاهَا. That person who purified his nafs is successful. And that person who mixed it with dust has failed, is unsuccessful. And Allah then goes on to mention an example of a person who mixed his nafs with dust and who was destroyed and doomed, and that is كَذَّبَتْ ثَمُودُ بِتَغْوَاهَا إِلِمْ بَعْتَ أَشْقَاهَا فَقَالَ لَهُمْ رَسُولُ اللَّهِ نَاقَةَ اللَّهِ وَسُقْيَاهَا فَكَذَّبُوهُ فَعَقَرُوهَا فَدَمْدَمَ عَلَيْهِمْ رَبُّهُمْ بِذَنْبِهِمْ فَسَوَّاهَا وَلَا يَخَافُ. Look at the people of Thamud.
and look at the wretched person Qudar ibn Salih, who killed that miracle of Allah, that she camel which Allah produced by his own power for the Nabi Salih alayhi salam. He murdered that animal and he was disrespectful. He had no regard, no haya, no sharam, no shame, and he killed that animal. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala also sent azab on them, and Allah finished and wiped out the whole people of Thamud. And wala yakhafu uqbaha, Allah is not scared of any repercussions or anybody coming to take revenge from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah can do what he likes, he is powerful. So Allah mentions that ego-worshipping person and that community who were ego-worshippers. Allah said, nafsaniyat, nafsaniyat. You have to control your ego, nafs. What is happening on social media is that nafs is going out of control. Your nafsaniyat, your ego is out of control. You can't control. Once you're on that computer, nowadays you don't even need computer, you don't even need laptop, iPhone 5, S3, or iPod, iPad, whatever is there, and you can spend hours and hours on it. So the main harm and nuqsan and damage that happens to a person is ego worshipping. Nafsaniyat, his ego becomes big and large and it bubbles up like a balloon and then it bursts, it goes out of control, he doesn't know where his life is heading. So your nafs should be under control, purified, clean. Your nafs is going out of control on the social media. This is one of the biggest harms or greatest harms of social media. And the other things come beneath it. Like for example, waste of time. Time is your most valuable asset. الْوَقْتُ أَنْفَسُ مَا عُنِيْتَ بِحِفْظِهِ وَأُرَاهُ أَسْهَلَ مَا عَلَيْكَ يَضِيعُ. Time is your most precious asset. You are being told to protect it, take care of it. And I see that it's the most easily wasted commodity that you possess. It's all most easily wasted. Hasan Basri rahmatullahi alayhi used to say, Ya ibn Adam, innama anta ayyam, fa idha zahaba yawmun, zahaba ba'd. Son of Adam, you are the name of day. A day in your life passes by, you have passed. Every minute that is passing by, you are passing by. You are finishing. You are going closer and closer and closer and closer and closer to your death. You know what it was when death is coming? Not only old people die, young people die as well. Have you ever carried the janazah of a friend of yours? Who is your friend, who you used to play with, and who you used to hang around with, and then you buried him with your own hands? No bimari, nothing. Just suddenly death comes and finishes. You want to go. الناس في غفلاتهم ورحى المنية تطحن. People are in their negligence and the chakki is going round and round of more. The chakki of death, kakayenge chakki go? The millstone of death is moving round. Like you have that Moulinex mixer and it's mixing inside. So it's the dough and the atta, so that Moulinex mixer is going round and round all the time. Somebody is dying somewhere. Nobody is here to stay forever. Somebody, otherwise this world there will be no place to put feet on this earth. So people are being born and dying, birth and death. It's a continuous process. So we have to remember, we have to die as well. So one of the harms is wasting of time. Time is our most valuable thing. Why stay over there for hours and hours, hours and hours? And time wasting. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the qasam of time, wal asr, innal insana illa alladhina amanu wa amilu salihat wa tawasaw bil haqq wa tawasaw bis sabr. Another problem with social media is ghaflat. Ghaflat is a bimari, a sickness, negligence. You are ghafil, you forget Allah. When you go on social media, you remember Allah, you are ghafil. Your mind is not with Allah, your mind is somewhere else. You don't realize that Allah is watching me. Allah is looking at me. Allah is looking at my every move. Allah is looking at my every click. Allah is looking at every letter that I type on the computer or on the iPhone or whatever I am saying. Allah is watching my every move. He is watching my eyes. He is watching my thoughts. He is watching my movements. He is looking at me. You are unaware of that. His being unaware is غفلة. اقترب للناس حسابهم وهم في غفلة معرضون ما يأتيهم من ذكر من ربهم محدث إلا كانوا عنه معرضين. حساب كتاب is very close, but people are in negligence, turning away and doing something else. Turning away from Allah, turning away from the hereafter, turning away from the hisab. وَلَقَدْ خَلَقْنَا الْإِنسَانِ. We have created man. وَنَعْلَمُ مَا تُوَسْوِسُ بِهِ نَفْسُهُ. We know what his nafs is whispering in him. وَنَحْنُ أَقْرَبُ إِلَيْهِ مِنْ حَبْلِ الْوَرِيدِ. We are more closer to him than his jugular ring. إِذْ يَتَلَقَّى الْمُتَلَقِّيَانِ عَنِ الْيَمِينِ وَعَنِ الشِّمَالِ الْقَعِيدِ. There are two soldiers, one on his right, one on his left. They are noting down everything. Like the speech of mine is being recorded. Similarly, the angels are recording every word I say, every move I make, every blink of the eye which takes place is being noted down. عَنِ الْيَمِينِ وَعَنِ الشِّمَالِ الْقَعِيدِ. ما يلفظ من قول إلا لديه رقيب عتيد. Every word that comes out is noted down. And word, القلم وحد لسانعين. قلم, you write something with a pen, is also word. So in the olden days there is a pen and paper. Now we have the computer. And we have the typewriters, computers, mobile. Every word you utter, every word you type, every word you write is being noted down. Not, it's not just saved in your iPhone, in your email, in your messages, and in your text. It's also saved by someone on the right and left as well. And all that will be presented in the court of Allah on the day of Qiyamah. Everything. People will come with books and registers as far as the eyes can see. All that will have been noted down with the Malaika. Jot it down. You stay in a small meeting for half an hour of some executives, and then someone who is noting down, whose job is just to note down the minutes of the meeting and see how big that file comes, how many papers he has to write, a jotter book. Look at the newspaper reporters, how they jot down everything. For one incident, they finish off one book and they write, everything you say is noted down, recorded, written down. So the angels are writing down. You become unaware of that. This is called ghaflah. So we have the nafsaniyat. Number two, we have the time, wasting of time. And number three, we have the ghaflah. And then we move on to pictures. Tasweer. You watch pictures on there. Pictures which you shouldn't be watching. Photos which you shouldn't be watching. And not only watching, you also put photos on there. Your own photo. And maybe you think that you're okay, your face. But what if you take your clothes off and then take your photo? Is that okay? Not just the chest, your whole body. There are people out there who put photos of their genitals on their face. And you will be watching them. So you open their account, you on there, so blah blah blah, Joe blog, and you don't know what he put on there, and you're watching all that on the Facebook. The girl putting on their photos. Outside on the street, you will see she's in hijab. But afterwards, when she goes home, she opens herself in front of the video camera, reveals herself, opens her hair, and the people on the other side are looking. She takes her own photo and puts it on the Facebook. And over here on the street, maybe a few people might have seen her. But on the internet, the whole world is watching her. Anybody can see her. So she's doing hijab over here, but be hijabi on the internet. No hijab on there. On face, hair, beauty, everything is open. Pictures, photos, which we should be careful of. Photos are only allowed through necessity, for passports, for driving license, for necessity. Other than that, photos should be avoided. Same is the case with videos. Necessity, some necessity, Allah knows what, okay, but out of necessity. So we should be careful of that. In this day and age, this masala has got a bit out of hand. We don't know what to do. TVs, channels. If we see there is so much fitna on the channels as well. Fitna of aqeedah. Too many channels or maybe, I don't know, other sects. Small sects putting on their own channels. We're not talking about other religions. We're talking about sects within our own religion. Sometimes we think we should have a channel for Ahl-e Haqq. We can't see anything that, like that over there because we have to portray the Haqq and the right. What we think is right to the people in the world and explain to them. We can't force anyone to accept our idea, but we have the right to explain to them. So, if Allah gives tawfiq, we open a nice channel for Haqq as well and explain the Haqq and truth to people. Inshallah, maybe Allah paves some way, then there will be some what you call flexibility in there. Because it will come under the necessity. It will become necessary, like that. Passport and driving license photo is necessary, this will become necessary. Otherwise, when something is not necessary, like for example, weddings, we should avoid photos and videos in weddings, because it's not something necessary. Weddings happen and come and go. We should not have photos of our maybe holiday snaps or videos of holiday. This is just shawqiya. So shawqiya, desire and all this, that should be avoided. Anyhow, this was just the subject of you go on the social website, you put your own photos and you watch other people's photos and you don't know where you're going, what you're watching, how much you are watching. This is another thing. So this leads to the sin of the eyes. So the photos lead to the sin of the eyes. So social media becomes a tool for the sin of the eyes. Now sin of the eye is not only in the Quran, it's also in the Torah, in the Zabur, in Injil, in previous religions as well. I have a friend in Bolton who is a new Muslim and he's a very wise person. Understand me? And he was saying, you know, I was a very religious person before embracing Islam. I was Christian and very religious. And he said, we used to go to the church and they used to teach us the seven deadly sins. And one of those seven sins was the sin of the eye. And they used to teach us we have to lower our gaze. Never stare at the opposite gender. So I said, you know, because of this nice akhlaq and characteristics of yours, maybe Allah guided you towards me. Because he used to control his eyes, look after himself, because that's what he was taught. He said, when we used to go to our church, we used to be given those rosary beads. And we used to be given some things of praying and invoking. So I said, that is tasbih. So the rosary bead. So you have to, you know, invoke and you have to remember. Tasbih is subhah, is only muzakira. It's to remind you of how much you have read and how much more you need to read. So it helps you to count. So it's a muzakira. So from there we learn some things as well. Anyway, we just mentioned the sin of the eye. That in other religions as well, there are good things which teach us good things. So they also take the sin of the eye as very, very detrimental, damaging for their spiritual health. And Islam, alhamdulillah, has opened this up more that we have to avoid the sin of the eye and we have to be really, really careful of what we see, what we look at, and what we watch. Pornography, tawbatullah, astaghfirullah. Pornographic pictures, pornographic movies. And this is shahwat, nafsaniyat. It kills off your ruhaniyat. It gets the janaza out of your spirituality. You are finished. Once you go into pornography, then astaghfirullah, astaghfirullah. It shatters family life. Your pornography causes divorces, separations, arguments, and fights within the household. So we have to be very, very careful with regards to this. And you know, for zina, you need energy and strength. But for watching pornography, you don't need any strength or energy. I went to this place, and you know, after the end of the day, nice lady, she called me on the phone, and she was crying. She said, I am 55, my husband will be older than me, but you know, at night, late at night, I go to sleep upstairs with my husband on the computer, watches pornographic movies. And my children are sleeping. I feel ashamed because the voice is too, volume is so high, you can hear everything upstairs. And I can't even say anything to him. If I try to say something, he attacks me and he attacks me, so I don't know what to do. Now, I can't say anything straight, so we still explain the bayan that pornography is haram, and you shouldn't be doing these things in your home. So elderly people, not talk about youngsters 15, 20 years, this is an elderly man. This young man, he says that I went in university, in the computer room, and there was this Muslim brother, he was alone in that computer room, and he was watching pornographic movie. So I went inside, and I looked, and he wasn't even ashamed. He didn't feel as if he was doing something wrong. He looked at me, and said, ah, smiling. I said, what are you doing watching this? He said, I'm only watching the porn. It keeps me away from becoming gay. Now you see how Shaitan has justified that sin in his eyes. It keeps me away from becoming gay. This is how he justifies his haram habit. So, this is what happens when you go on there. You start watching these things. May Allah protect us. May Allah take care of us. May Allah take care of our children as well. Also, moving on, among the harms of social media is, which we are getting very frequently these days, cyber bullying. And this has gone to limits where even the people, the society, feel it out of control. We have heard many, many cases. This young girl, whose boyfriend forced her and then took some nude pictures of her. And then he said, I'm going to post them on Facebook. And she said, don't do that. And he said, I'm going to do it. They were talking on the phone and he said, I'm going to post it now. And she said, I'm standing on the edge of the window. If you don't delete those photos now, I'm going to jump out and kill myself. Suicide. And he started laughing at her. You can do what you like. And she jumped off from the window and killed her.
Nice.
Her mother is now making a campaign and urging the government to do something about this, put some control on the media. And this is not just a single case. There are many, many cases of that type. There was an article in the Daily Mail in which it said that these young boys are forcing the girls to send them pictures of their breasts and then passing them around to their friends. And there is so much pressure on the young girls, they don't know what to do. They can't find any good friend. There is so much going on out there that young girls feel scared, they have to keep a chaperone with them. Chaperone meaning only two girls go together. No single girl goes alone with her boyfriend. Even if she goes for a coffee or somewhere in a social place, she has to have someone with her. Otherwise, she can't even trust her boyfriend with her. And all boys want from their girlfriends is what they see on the pornography. They want their girlfriends to behave like that porn actor is behaving on the set. And this sickness is not only in this country, it's become worldwide. There was this news that in Saudi Arabia, this woman took divorce from her husband even though she had to pay him 55 dakh or something real. She took him divorce from him for two reasons. One, he wasn't praying salah properly, and secondly, he used to watch pornography. She said, I won't divorce from him because he watches pornography. I was once returning from Emirates, Dubai, and I took the newspaper, Gulf News, open. On the front page, there was this news that this woman took divorce from her husband after 6 months because he used to have a huge plasma screen TV in the bedroom, and he would put porn movies on, and he would tell her, force her to do what she is doing over there. So she said, I can't do that. I am a Sharif woman. I can't do these types of hunger. And she said, no, you have to do it. She said, I can't die. So she fired from the world to the world. So this sickness is going to spread throughout the whole world. Now this is what is happening through the media that is going around. And we have to control ourselves. Control ourselves, you know, the eye. And this cyberbullying and what is happening in this manner in school, among the young generation, and all this, we have to be very careful with regards to that. Also, some other things are on the gossiping, backbiting, what I was mentioning. Also, false identities, lying. People on Facebook lie too much. They put their identity. A 50-year-old Buddha portrays himself like an 18-year-old young man. And then he makes friendship with young girls. And then when she ends up over there, she says, hey, I have to go. And you, Sheikh Suleiman Mullah, he mentioned in his bayan, his interview, that this person developed friendship with this girl, and chatting on whatever else, with a different name, change name, fuzzy name. And then they made friendship. After many days and weeks of chatting, they agreed to meet. And they said, we will meet in so-and-so mall, shopping center. And he said that I will be wearing this. And she said, I will be wearing this cloth. And they go over there and she meets him. You know who it turns out to? Father and daughter. The father was chatting with the daughter. They're in the house, different rooms. They don't know. They've changed their identities and they talk chatting with one another in this manner. This is the social media lying and false identities on there. Moving on. Making sins open. You sin and then you put it on Facebook. I've just been to the cinema, I watched this movie, and I love this movie, I love that. I've just had a drink, it was really nice. Toba toba, astaghfirullah. Making your sins open. You are revealing your sin. And we know the hadith. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, Kullu ummati mu'af, illa al-mujahirun. My whole ummah will remain in afiyat and peace and security. Allah will forgive yet of let off. Allah is pardoning, Allah is kind, merciful. Allah will let people off. Except for al-mujahideen, those who do sins jahra, openly, who are shameless, of no shame. For example, in the olden days, they used to say, a person who eats and drinks in front of people during the month of Ramadan, when people are going to the masjid, he's eating in the takeaway and people are watching him. He's doing bedwi and disrespect of the roza and fasting by eating openly in front of people. This is called sinning jahran, openly, shamelessly in front of everyone. Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, the whole ummah will stay with peace except these types of people. They will not be at peace and security. Any time Allah's ghadab can fall upon them, they are not with peace and security. وَإِنَّ مِنَ الْمَجَانَةِ أَنْ يَعْمَلَ الرَّجُلُ الْعَمَلِ فَيُصْبِحُ يَكْشِفُ سِتْرَ اللَّهِ وَقَدْ بَاتَ يَسْتُرُهُ رَبُّهُ. It is from the shamelessness of a person that he commits a sin by night. And then in the morning he boasts about that sin. Whereas he spent the night in such a manner that his Rabb was hiding him, concealing him. Rabb wanted to hide his sin, Rabb wanted to forgive him. But in the morning he opens it up. I committed this sin and that sin. This is what's happening in the social media, that people are sinning openly and revealing their sins. I have committed this and I have committed that. May Allah protect. Mm-hmm. If something happens, some mistakes happen, we should have that guilt, that remorse, that regret. This remorse and regret and nadamat will encourage you to do tawbah and to repent. But if that nadamat and regret, remorse goes, then you are finished. Your iman is gone. إِنَّ الْإِيمَانَ وَالْحَيَاءَ قُلِنَا جَمِيعًا فَإِذَا رُفِعَ أَحَدُهُمَا ارْتَفَعَ الْآخَرُ.
Haya and Iman are combined and joined together. If one goes, the other goes as well. If your Haya is gone, your Iman is gone too. Protect your Haya, modesty. Some Mashaykh have said, I just put the tweet on a few days ago. Forgot the name who said it. Malik bin Dinar. The worst punishment Allah can give to a heart is to take away the Haya and modesty from within it. Haya, modesty is gone, that's the worst punishment can be given to a person. So, on there, on social website, by revealing yourself, Haya is gone, modesty is gone, sharam is gone, you are careless, you are shameless. This is what happens on the social media. Also, one of the harms of social media is getting in touch with the wrong people. You don't know who the person on the other side. Just move a little bit from amal practice, come to aqidah. You know what is the aqidah of the person sitting on the other side. From which aqidah he belongs to. He might call himself a sheikh, he might call himself a mufti, he might call himself an allama, but you don't know who he is. You don't know who you're talking to. And you know something that is so much fitnah on the social website, that the enemies of Islam are using it to deviate Muslims. Allah. They're using it. They are calling themselves shuyukh. They will, on the Facebook, they will put photos of Makkah, Medina, on the internet. And if you think this is a nice person, and then slowly, they will give you injection after injection, until you are poisoned, you are running. You don't know who the person on that other side is. He might be calling himself, but he's not Shia. And there's so much fitna. There was a note on Twitter. Someone said that I have claimed to reverted to Islam and given myself an Islamic name. Now see stupid Muslims following my blog. on Twitter. Said I'm not a Muslim, but I've changed my name Islam and I have called myself Muslim, reverted. And now see stupid Muslim idiots following me. They're rushing behind me in numbers. Because we are so innocent, we are so naive. We don't pay attention. We don't look at who the person on the other side is. Be careful. Be careful. Be very, very careful. Who you are associating with. Like that coffee example I gave. In a coffee shop, that person is in front of you. And you can see him. You know what type of person he is. You can interact with him. You can feel him. But over here, you don't know who the person is, who you're talking to, and how he's going to corrupt it. A few days back, this lady phoned my wife, someone gave her our home number, and she said, I want to speak to Sheikh, please, I have a big problem. So, I said, okay. She said, can I come down, can I bring my daughter down as well? So I said, okay, no problem, come down. When? She said, whenever you want to, no problem, I'll be available. She had a problem. So she comes down, the daughter, my wife is sitting there, and she and her two daughters there. 19-year-old young girl, she was on Facebook, and she was interacting with someone who was a Shia. And he had put in her mind so much about Shiaism that this Sunni girl was on the verge of becoming Shia. Not only that, the person had taught him a little bit about deen on there, and then he said to her that now because I am your teacher, I have taught you Quran, how to read Quran from Masail. You know, they used to chat until late at night. And then now I have taught you, I have a right over you, and you have to marry me. And she said, no, I can't do that. And he said, you have to now. So she was on the verge of accepting. And he also said that we are having a special conference somewhere in the Middle East, and that conference is lying in wait for the promised Imam. He's about to come maybe next year or the year after, and we are having a huge gathering, and you have to come over there. All you have to do is just buy a ticket, and we will take you from the airport, we will give you lodging, food, everything paid for, and we will return. And she was ready, she was begging her mom to buy her a ticket to go over there. 19-year-old girl, how far she has gone. So her mother didn't know what to do. She brought him to me. And alhamdulillah, I spoke to her for maybe half an hour, 5 minutes. I explained to her. I answered her questions. And by the end, she said to her mom, okay, mom, thank you. No, I don't want to go anymore. Alhamdulillah, she repented. And she stayed fast on, alhamdulillah, the great queen of her mother, her daughter, her father, and her family. This is what's happening on the social media out there. People are just sitting there. And these types of aqeedah and beliefs and everything, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect our engineering. One of the other harms is, we can say, losing connection with family members. You know, our homes are no longer homes, they have become hotels. In a hotel, you will see people stay in their rooms, and there is dining hall downstairs. They come down to eat, quickly back in their room, and one room, lodger doesn't know what the other person in the other room is doing and who he is. They don't even talk to one another. Similarly, in our room, the mom cooks the food, and the young man comes, his sister, brother, they come, they take food out, eat quickly, rush up the room. And everybody is in their own room. One roommate doesn't know what the other room is doing. The parents don't know what the father, the son, and the daughter are doing. Everybody into their room. You know, someone tell me this very nice text. This young child in a school, primary school, the teacher tells them to write an essay about what they want from their parents. Primary school child is writing an essay, and in that essay he writes that I want to become a TV, because when something is wrong with me, then I will be paid immediate attention and people will be watching me all the time. They will take care of me. As soon as something happens to someone, is called, engineer is called, phone calls are made. And he went on to write very nicely in that essay that I want to become TV because my father can pay me attention, my grandfather can pay me attention, my brother can pay me attention, my sister can pay me attention. So the teacher, she looked at that and she got into tears. And she brought the essay home and she, it was for marking, she showed her husband that essay. That look, I told the children, and this is what one child wrote. And he read it. And then he said, oh, this child's parents seem really cruel. They're not paying any attention to the child. And you know what she said? This essay is our child's essay. Mm-hmm. Our own child wrote this essay. Mm-hmm. This is how parents are neglecting the children because of their social media and their habits on it. Also, some other things that are wrong with is addictive, is extremely addictive. Once you go on there, on WhatsApp, someone told me that among the pros and cons, someone sent me this then I said, WhatsApp, you know, you want to control yourself, but one click, two clicks, and then you're gone. You don't know how long you've been on it for. So it's very, very addictive. Anything addictive, you try and avoid. Also, Mufti Sahib mentioned intermingling in the name of Dawah. I'm only giving her Dawah. I'm only trying to explain. And you don't know, your nafs is going out of control. And in the name of Dawah, Deen, people are intermingling. And many, many weird things are happening. Antisocial behavior, trends, and things like that. Now, we have understood to some degree what social media is, what are the benefits, and what are the harms. Now, how do we protect ourselves? This requires a funny below. Jazakallah. Bismillah. Another 1 hour is behind. Some of the time is inshallah. Mufti Javed Sahib will do it, Mufti Kishad Sahib will do it, Mawlana Badruddin Sahib will do it.
Ittaqullah wa kunu ma'a as-sadiqin. Fear Allah and be in the company of the truthful people. As-sadiqin, who are true in their words, true in their actions. There is no difference in their words, in their actions. They do what they say what they do. These are sadiqin, true to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. قال الله هذا يوم ينفع الصادقين صدقهم أولئك الذين صدقوا وأولئك هم المتقون ليسأل الصادقين عن صدقهم وأعد للكافرين عذابا أليما. Stay with the صادقين أولياء الله. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions أولياء الله بين هذا. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said الأخلاء يومئذ بعضهم لبعض عدو إلا المتقين. All friends on the day of Qiyamah will become enemies. Except for muttaqeen, those who have taqwa, they will remain friends on the day of Qiyamah. Those who do not have taqwa, they will become each other's enemies. So if you were friends on the Facebook, on Twitter, on social media, but you didn't have taqwa, then you will be enemies of each other on the day of Qiyamah. You will be doing la'nat and cursing upon one another. وَيَوْمَ الْقِيَامَةِ يَكْفُرُ بَعْضُكُمْ لِبَعْضٍ وَيَلْعَنُ بَعْضُكُمْ بَعْضًا وَمَأْوَاكُمُ النَّارُ وَمَا لَكُمْ مِنْ نَاصِرِينَ. This is what will happen on the day of Qiyamah if you are in the company of wrong people, wrong friendship. So you have to stay in the company of right people. And right people, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, وَتَوَاصَوْا بِالْحَقِّ وَتَوَاصَوْا بِالصَّبْرِ وَتَوَاصَوْا بِالْحَقِّ وَتَوَاصَوْا بِالْمَرْحَمَةِ أُولَٰئِكَ أَصْحَابُ الْمَيْمَنَةِ. Who encourage one another with truth. If you are doing something wrong, your friend tells you, that's the right friend. Who encourage one another to be merciful to one another. Who are caring, sharing, who care for one another. These are good people. These are the good friends. So stay in the company of good friends. This good friendship, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, that if you have right company, good friendship, then on the day of Qiyamah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will call these people who have no relations among themselves. But they love one another for the sake of Allah. They have friendship with one another for the sake of Allah. Allah will say, أَيْنَ الْمُتَحَابُّونَ بِجَلَالِي الْيَوْمَ أُظِلُّهُمْ فِي ظِلِّي يَوْمَ لَا ظِلَّ إِلَّا ظِلِّي. Those who have friendship for the sake of Allah. Even if you went on social media, Facebook, Twitter, only for the right mashayikh, the ulama, and you learn from them, you stay, you are like in their company, you are learning from them, then inshallah on the day of Qiyamah you will be resurrected with them, among them. And Allah will give you the shade of the arsh on the day of Qiyamah, along with the awliya of Allah, and along with the buzurgan adeen, mashayikh, sulahai ikram. Allah said, وَجَبَتْ مَحُبَّتِي لِلْمُتَحَابِينَ فِيَّ وَالْمُتَجَالِسِينَ فِيَّ وَالْمُتَبَادِلِينَ فِيَّ وَالْمُتَزَاوِلِينَ فِيَّ. My muhabbat and love is value and necessary for those who used to love one another for my sake, who used to sit with one another for my sake, who used to visit one another for my sake, who used to spend money on one another for my sake. Then for these people, my muhabbat is wajib and lazim. So even if you go on a social media, you are sitting with the person who is in front of you, interacting with them, then that person should be a pious person. You should know that person. I know who this man is. I know who this person is. If you visit any website, you should know whose website it is and who that person is. He's telling you, you should know, you should have 100% confidence that what he's telling you is correct. The information, the knowledge, the ilm which he's giving you is in line with Quran and Shariat and Deen. Ibn Sirin said, إِنَّ هَذَا الْعِلْمَ دِينٌ فَانْظُرُوا عَمَّنْ تَأْخُذُونَ دِينَكُمْ. Ilm, knowledge is also part of your deen. So make sure you are careful where you take your deen from. Be careful, be mindful where you take your deen from. So, this is being careful. My young friends, boys, girls, young, old, be very careful if you use the social media. Read it with the right intention, for the right reason, with moderation, staying within the limits, staying within the framework of Sharia, to benefit from the ulama, shuyukh, to learn something from them, and not to mess around. Not to corrupt your deen, your aqidah, your amal, your life. Not to abandon, while abandoning salah, while paying disrespect to your parents, disregarding your duties of learning, education, homework, ifaz.
You know, people become happy, but they can't complete it. They struggle to finish it. Reason, because they always want these types of things. I went to one place and half his class was going, and Maulana Sahib said, you know, there are boys who waste so much time and they don't learn. One boy, he goes from madrasa to home and he spends 4 hours on the computer. I said, tell his father to take the computer away. And he said, no, Maulana Sahib, I can't do that. I told his father that you know, limit and restrict his time on the computer. And he said, I said that in the house, and my wife got on me and she started arguing, and hey, blah, 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 blah. I was so fed up. I said, okay, my dad, don't leave me. This is what's happening. Students are spending, pupils are spending too much time on there, and that is how, you know, they are taken away from me. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give us the fiqh and the understanding of our deen and the ability to put into practice what we learn. Inshallah, it will be beneficial for you. Any questions?
Can you share your Twitter account with us so we can get from
there? No problem. Just go on Twitter, Tafsir Rahimi. Or you can write Tafsir, or you can write Sheikh Abdul Rahim as well. From both sides, you will get there, inshallah. TAFSERRAHIMI. That's our website. Tafsir Rahimi is my website.
Say that again.
RAHEMI. Okay? TafsirRahimi.com. That's my website. And on there, if you go on the website, you will go on Twitter as well. Because they are both connected. And alhamdulillah, from time to time, you put good articles, audios, videos as well. You can benefit from that. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless you.
We have the opportunity to go and speak to the Mashaykh and the Baba, we don't
need to speak to you. That's a good point, Maulana Sahib. Very good. Jazakallah for reminding me. You know, personal interaction is 100 times more beneficial than computer interaction. Right? Like you are sitting with me now, okay? If you go listen to my bayan on the website, you will benefit, take benefit. But not as much as sitting over here in the company in this environment. So, we have to keep in mind that, you know, if you have mashayikh around you, your ulama, your fulaha, and you get time, you should go and sit in their company. Sit with them. You know, even if you sit for a while, you know, the mashayikh, their example is like the flower Raki Rani, right? This flower is beautiful fragrance, like Mogra. Now, at night time, it lets out and emanates the fragrance. If you sit in that bath, you will feel so nice, you'll be relaxed. All your tension will go away. So the flower is not talking, but you are getting that relaxation and that fragrance. And similarly, even if mashayikh don't say a word, they are quiet. But still you will benefit from their company by sitting with you. Hazrat Khaja Baqi Billah Rahmatullahi Alayhi, a great Shaykh. Mujaddid Al-Bisani Rahmatullahi Alayhi Shaykh. He came to in his company, he had two other friends as well. And those friends stayed for a few days and then one of them said that, yeah, our Shaykh is very good, but he doesn't see him and he never talks. So I don't think he's a coming. The other one said, no, our Shaykh is coming, but he's not a mukammil. He can't complete another person. Hazrat Mujaddid Sahib said that I know me. I will make such comments about my Shaykh. I feel that if in this dunya, if someone got a Shaykh, then it was either the Sahaba who got Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam as Shaykh, or in my lifetime, I got my Shaykh Khaja Baqi Billah. The best Shaykh I can have is Hazrat Khaja Sahib. So I won't divert my attention to anyone besides my Shaykh. Khaja Baqi Billah rahmatullahi alayhi was a very quiet, silent personality. But he was a very high caliber. And he had a kashif of this, what happened in the chamber among conversation. And when the majlis was taking place, Hazrat Khaja Sahib said, bhai, jisko humari khamoshi se fayda nahi hota, usko humare bolne se bhi fayda nahi hota. Who does not benefit from my silence cannot benefit from my talk. So you have to sit with the mashayikh. You have mashayikh, go and sit with them. MashaAllah, you know they have their connection, their spiritual connection, continuous chain, khilafat from their shaykh, from their shaykh, from their shaykh. Sit with them, benefit from them. MashaAllah, you have Hazrat Maulana Bahauddin Sahib here in Birmingham, the Majlis in the Habib Trust. Go,
I'm not sitting in the company of Mashayikh. There are other Mashayikh from whom your heart is attached, from whom you can benefit. So, better than this social interaction is personal interaction. Sit with the Mashayikh, you will benefit more, inshallah. So, this is something which should be noted. Don't give too much importance to over here. Much importance should be on that side. Staying with the ulama, one of Faisal Sahib, Mufti Sahib, one of other Sahib, all of those, sit in their company and benefit from them. This is better than just going over there and much more beneficial, inshallah. See you. Durud Sharif for you. سبحانك اللهم وبحمدك وتبارك اسمك وتعالى جدك وجل ثناؤك ولا اله غيرك. اللهم ربنا لك الحمد حمدا دائما ولك الشكر شكرا دائما. اللهم ربنا لك الحمد حمدا كثيرا طيبا مباركا فيه من السماوات والارض وما بينهما الى ما شئت من شيء بعد. اللهم صل وسلم وبارك على سيدنا ومولانا محمد عبدك ورسولك النبي الامين نبي الرحمه كما تحب وترضى عدد ما تحب وترضى كلما ذكرت الذاكرون وكلما غفر عن ذكره الغافلون. اللهم ربنا اتنا في الدنيا حسنه وفي الآخرة حسنة وقنا عذاب النار. ربنا اغفر لنا ذنوبنا وإسرافنا في أمرنا وثبت أقدامنا وانصرنا على القوم الكافرين. رب اغفر وارحم وأنت خير الراحمين. اللهم اغفر لنا وارحمنا وعافنا وارزقنا واسترنا واجبرنا واهدنا وارفعنا. إنا لما أنزلت إلينا من خير فقراء. اللهم لا تؤمن منا مكرا ولا تنسنا ذكرا ولا تأتك عنا سترا ولا تجعلنا من الغافلين. اللهم لا تقم منا مكرا ولا تنسنا ذكرا ولا تأتك عنا سترا ولا تجعلنا من الغافلين. اللهم افتح أقفال قلوبنا بذكرك وأكمل علينا بنعمتك وأسبغ علينا من فضلك واجعلنا من عبادك الصالحين. اللهم اجعلنا نعظم شكرك ونكثر ذكرك ونتبع نصيحتك ونحفظ وصيتك. اللهم إنا نسألك إيمانا كاملا ويقينا صادقا وقلبا خاشعا ولسانا ذاكرا وتوبة نصوحا وتوبة قبل الموت وراحة عند الموت ومغفرة ورحمة بعد الموت والعفو عند الحساب والفوز بالجنة والنجاة من النار. يا أرحم الراحمين منزول بك كل حاجة. يا أرحم الراحمين. O Allah, you are the most merciful among those who show mercy. You are Al-Hamul Rahim. You are Al-Karmul Akram. You are Ajwadul Ajwadeen. You are Rahimul Musakeen. You are Hannan, Mannan, Badir Samawat. You are Abul Jalal Akram. You are worthy of all praise. You are the most beautiful of names. O Allah, you are the possessor of all praise and you deserve all praise. O Allah, we praise you in the best manner which we can, in the manner in which our beloved Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam praised you. O Allah, we beseech you, first of all, to send perpetual blessings and salawat and salam and greetings to our Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, to your beloved Nabi sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Shower your rahmah and mercy upon his Rozay Sharifa, upon his grave. O Allah, thereafter we beseech you to give us all those good things which he asked for. To protect us from all those trials, fitnas from which he sought your protection. Yeah. O Allah, we beg you to forgive our sins. Yeah. O Allah, we beg you to forgive our sins of the eyes, sins of the ears, sins of the tongue, sins of the heart and mind, sins of the hands, feet, our private parts. Yeah. O Allah, forgive all our sins, wash away our sins. Yeah. O Allah, cleanse us, purify us from all our sins which we have committed in the past. And protect us from sinning and disobeying you in future. O Allah, keep us steadfast on Sirat al-Mustaqim until the day we die. O Allah, give us tawfiq to obey you. Give us tawfiq to fulfill your commands. O Allah, give us tawfiq to obey your instructions. O Allah, give us tawfiq to pray 5 times a day. Give us tawfiq to bow down before you, to prostrate before you, to understand your right and to fulfill your right and your haqq. O Allah, take care of us, protect us, have mercy upon us. O Allah, have mercy upon the whole Ummah. O Allah, protect the whole Ummah from all fitnah, from all trials, tribulations, temptations, from all fitnah. In those fitnahs which we can see, those which we can't see. O Allah, protect us from all fitnahs. Ma zahara minha wa ma batan. Those within us and those outside, O Allah, protect us from all fitnahs. O Allah, keep us steadfast on Sirat al-Mustaqim until the day we die. Have mercy upon our young, our old, our men, our women, our ladies. O Allah, and spread the word of Hidayah through
throughout this whole community, and throughout this whole city, throughout the whole country, and throughout the whole world. Oh Allah, give us the tawfiq to spread this word of Hidayah. Take this truth and haq to those who are searching for it, to those who are yearning for the truth. Oh Allah, let us deliver this truth to them. And oh Allah, give them the tawfiq to realize the haqiqat and haqqaniyat of Deen al-Islam. Oh Allah, make their hearts soft for Deen al-Islam. Soften their hearts. Oh Allah, bring them closer to Deen al-Islam. Give them the understanding of the Deen of Islam. And give them the ability to accept the truth and to practice upon the truth. And give us the tawfiq and ability to preach the truth wherever we are. Take care of us, protect us. Oh Allah, take care of our mashayikh, our ulama, our sulaha. Oh Allah, take care of them, protect them. Oh Allah, give them good health, restore them good health. Oh Allah, give them barakah in their health, in their wealth, in their risk, in their awlad, in their children, in their time, in their faith, and in their uloom. And oh Allah, keep their shade over us for a long, long time. And give us tawfiq to benefit from our asatiza, our mashayikh. Those among our asatiza who have passed away, shower your mercy upon their grave. Elevate their ranks in Jannah with their indiyin in Jannah of your door. Oh Allah, from among us, whoever's parents have died, shower your mercy upon their graves as well. And whoever's parents are alive, give them good health, take care of them, protect them. Give us tawfiq to cherish and value our parents and do their khidmat, take their dua. And Allah, keep their share over us with good health and keep our share in their duas for us as well. And protect them with health, take care of them. And Allah, keep us all steadfast in salam. Allah, accept this jalsa, this gathering which has taken place. Give good reward to those who organized it, and give good reward to those who participated in it as well. And Allah, give us tawfiq to propagate the deen around the whole world, and accept our humble efforts, forgive our shortcomings, and Allah, accept our humble du'as. Give us all those good things which your beloved Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam asked from you, and protect us from all those fitnas, trials, tribulations, problems from which He sallallahu alayhi wa sallam sought your protection, and accept our du'as, fulfill all our needs of dunya and akhirat, and all our be pleased with us, and keep us steadfast on sirat al-mustaqim till the day we die. When our time comes to go to you, O Allah, give us death with kalma la ilaha illallah Muhammadur Rasulullah on our lips, and give us death in such a state that you are pleased with us. We are from you. You like meeting us, we like meeting you. Make our life of qabr easy for us, make our life of Maidan al-Hashr easy for us. And O Allah, make the standing before you on the day of Qiyamah easy for us. O Allah, give us the shape of your arsh on the day of Qiyamah. Give us, O Allah, the water of all the Qawthar at the blessed hands of Rasulullah. Make our hisab, kitab, reckoning easy for us. O Allah, give us our certificate in our right hand. O Allah, make us happy on that day, be pleased with us. Help us cross the bridge over Jahannam and admit us all into Jannah along with our Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, along with the Sahaba, Tabi'een, Aimma, Sulaha, Mufassireen, Atqiya, Awliya Allah. O Allah, admit us and take us into Jannah along with our ulama, Sulaha, Shaykh, and be pleased. أكسب أبو عاز ربنا تقبل منا إنك أنت السميع العليم وتب علينا يا مولانا إنك أنت التواب الرحيم وصلى الله وسلم على سيدنا محمد وآله وصحبه أجمعين.